Salutations from space, folks. This is Gemini Brett, the Astrolonaut of More Than Astrology, here to sip some tea with Taurus and to prepare to set intentions for the 2015 Taurus Moon Game. So I've put a bunch of roses in the pot here because Taurus is the sign of spring, the beauty of the flowers. And then we can play some teacup tarot. So my wonderful friend Elizabeth has made these great ceramic teacups of the planets. Venus. Perfect. Neptune. Incredible. And one more for you. The Earth. Gosh, that's perfect. I feel like maybe it was even set up that way. Yeah, the Earth, you know, Taurus is an Earth sign, and Taurus understands that of all these planets in our solar system, all these beautiful energies we get to participate with, one is the most important, and that is the Earth. So we ground ourselves into the Earth. Smell her roses, yeah, stop to smell the flowers. Find the moment now. And enjoy a tasty cup of tea together. Yum. Well, the Moon Game gives us an opportunity to really get to know the archetypes. So we set intentions to anchor their light and to purge their shadow and allow the principal phases of the moon during the course of the month to set these seeds of intentions to sprout and to flower and to fruit. So what are the seeds of intentions to plant around Taurus? Who is Taurus? The second sign on the traditional wheel of life that starts with Aries, the place of the birth, coming in from the Piscean waters of all that is through the birth canal into us, into me. That's Aries, right? And then Taurus is like climbing to the breast for something to eat. It is what sustains us, yeah? What gives us that physical comfort. And then it's the body, it's the earth, right? So the dance and the yoga and the natural music, it's the Epicurean. This word, so much reserved for the foodie in our day and time, but it's really about all of the senses. So taste, yes, but sight and smell and hearing and touch, especially touch. Taurus is sensuality, it is intimacy as an art form. How can that possibly apply when we hear that Taurus is the bull? Well, that's kind of bullshit. And this is bringing our attention to some of the Taurus shadows that we can allow ourselves to release. To find the shadows of the archetypes, it's sometimes best just to go straight into kind of the commercially accepted energies of the archetypes, which really present their shadows so much more than their light. And we're told that Taurus, bull-headed, thick-skinned, stubborn, and that is available in the Taurus shadow, and investigating why it can bring us to what is the light of Taurus and how has it been twisted. As I like to say, Taurus, feminine, yin, earth, is the cow that has been testiculized, and we're given this bull. You know, some time ago, it was a lot of bull worship. Apis bull in Egypt, for example, but the cow was around long before that, and this was Hathor, who was goddess of joy and beauty and grace and childbirth, the goddess whose milk fed the gods and created the very Milky Way. And the same comes to us from the Hindu tradition. She is Lakshmi, grace and joy and beauty, abundance, childbirth, the goddess whose milk fed the gods and produced the very Milky Way. So what has happened to this cow? And how has it been testiculized into this nature of the Taurus bull that we're told about now? And how do we bring her back and to really honor the true beauty and sensuality and love of the Taurus archetype? Well, Taurus is the fixed sign of spring, right? Cardinal, fixed, mutable. And so cardinal is the beginning. This is Aries, the new entrance into the new season. And then fixed is when the energy of the season is fully fixed in. So it's the Taurus time, when the sun's there anyway, when we start getting the full bloom of the flowers and the birds and the bees and this kind of thing, and the beauty of nature. And so maybe fixed for that reason, because the season's energy is fully fixed. But I like that they're called the fixed signs, because fix yourself to fix the world. And shamanic astrology considers the fixed signs to be a service to self-interest. And I call them service to self-growth. I call the cardinal signs service to others. The fixed signs, like Taurus, service to self-growth. And then the mutable signs, like Virgo, Sagittarius, Pisces, where the remaining phases of this month's moon principal phases will fall, service to spirit, as shamanic astrology does. So what is this idea of service to self-growth? Is this selfish? No, not at all. As within, so without. Heal yourself to heal the world. Fix yourself to fix the world. And this is why they are the fixed signs. And Taurus does this in the earth, in the body. This is fixing the world by bringing more beauty to it. And we do that when we honor our own beauty. When we honor the temple of the body, of form. And our diet, what sustains us. So that's not just what we eat. I mean, it is about the carrots and the kale, or whatever that may be. But everything that we're taking in, you know, what are we watching? What kind of media are we choosing? All these things I really feel are kind of important to us. Contemplations, you know, that billboard that you drive by, whatever it may be. And living in the city, as most of us do, you know, we're just completely surrounded by all of that nonstop energy. And so Taurus really, in a sense, wants to live that simple life and to strip it down and to come out here to nature, you know, find your way to a lake. Really, we should be recording this outside, but it's super windy, so I couldn't. And I wanted to drink some roses with you and Taurus and Venus. Anyway. But how can we simplify things? How can we slow down a little bit? Taurus really allows us to find presence, to take things at Earth's pace, where grace lives, you know, to live in the moment now, which really is the only moment, to stop and smell the roses, and to connect to our body and to our senses, to the taste and the smell and the sight and the hearing and the touch and the dance and the yoga and the tantra, you know. We are here to experience the earth in our monkey suit, so let's be monkeys. Let's put our bare feet into the soil of that most important planet and peel a banana and scratch our armpits and the whole thing. And start with the earth before we even get into the other planets. And then the sun that brings us heat, and the moon that brings the tides, and all of this. So these are the intentions this month. How can we set intentions to simplify, to ground, to embody, to have a practice of pace? And in that place, we allow ourselves to receive. This is a very important energy of the Taurus Mystery School, our investigation. There are so many givers on the Wheel of Life in these archetypes, but Taurus is the one true divine receiver. And how can we really receive that? You know, Venus, goddess of beauty, she didn't have a problem receiving the many tributes that were handed her way, simply because she was so beautiful. And I love in the story of the golden apple that began the Trojan War. knew Paris had to choose between Venus and Athena and Hera, Venus Aphrodite in the Greek. And he chose beauty, right? And what's wrong with that? And in this place of beauty, you know, and really knowing our own beauty, can we even receive a compliment that helps us feel beautiful? Because when we do, we bring more beauty to the world. And as within, so without, right? So when we see the beauty of Earth, we're reminded of our beauty because we are that. And when we know our beauty, we bring more beauty to the Earth. And so this nature of receiving, you know, can you get that hour-long massage without jumping straight into the guilt of now I have to give an hour and a half massage back? Or it's got to be perfectly even. But to know that energy is exchanged in many ways, and what the giver is truly wishing for in return for the gift that they give is simple, honorable acknowledgement and true loving receiving of that gift, you know? So thank you, honey. That's the best massage I've ever had. I feel great. You are a magician, and I love you. That's the greatest gift to the giver. And that's when receiving is giving. We're not taught that. We're taught the exact opposite. Giving is receiving, which obviously can be very true as well. But for the Taurus Mystery School, it's exploring the other side of that thing. Where can we really allow ourselves to soften and to receive, you know? And that sensuality, that tantric exchange, it requires that, right? We have to let go of the warrior mode and the defenses. You know, Aries in this last month, we're charging to the top of the mountain to summit it, taking on the challenge. And Taurus says, okay, now you're there. Now stop. Chill out. Sit down. Smell the roses. Feel the breeze. Feel the sun on you, you know? Look at the stars. Relax. Slow down, you know? I mean, look at Ganesha, maybe. And, you know, Taurus, I feel, is more about the rat on which he rides than the rat race, you know? And just connecting to the land and to the animals and to the birds and all this stuff that is earth, right? And these earth signs and these yin signs and this receiving signs. So in the earth signs, I look to Capricorn as the trunk of the tree, the roots, and Virgo is the leaf. It's always reaching for the light of spirit and doing the inner work. But Taurus is the fruit and the flower. It wants to be tasted. It wants to be smelled. And the pollination is necessary to keep the whole scene going, after all, is it not? So this month, can we set intentions about softening and not being in that bull place? And allowing ourselves to receive, and allowing ourselves to slow down, and thinking about what truly sustains us, thinking about our diet, and again, not just about food, but what are we taking in? Very shortly after this new moon, which is Sunday, May 17th, 9 o'clock p.m. about, on the West Coast, Mercury will go retrograde the very next day, and through the sign of Gemini. And I'll speak more about that in the longer version of this recording. But for the short version, I'll just finish by saying that these Taurus intentions that we set, we have a week of that. How can we relax the stubborn, thick-skinned, bull-headed thing that we've heard about and really come into the Epicurean, the senses and the slowing down and the receiving and the beauty and the tantra and the grace, you know, this great word. So a week of setting intentions around this, and then we get first quarter moon. In the time of tensions, the seeds sprout, the wind and the rain comes in. And this is in the sign of Virgo. And so, right, you know, there's Virgo, I want to do the earth this way, and Taurus, no, but these are the seeds I planted, but it's got to be a spiritual thing, and there's got to be a purpose, and, you know, there's got to be a work to this thing, and let's be meticulous about it. And Taurus is saying, no, let's be meticulous about just chilling out, right? Let's do the earth that way. Let's try the fruit that the leaf's brought some hard work from, you know, to produce. And Virgo says, no, but you can't have fruit without the leaf. I must receive the light or whatever. So there's a little tension there, just like, how do we play with the earth energies? And Taurus, which is so sensual, can find some tension from the Virgo archetype, which is kind of married to spirit and can get into the virginity and the renunciation in that way. That's certainly not all that Virgo's about, you know. But when we're looking at the tensions of Virgo to Taurus, that's certainly one of them, you know. And even like the patriarchal projections of chastity is, you know, cover your wrists and cover your ankles, and this is Virgo. That's the bane to Taurus, because Taurus must be sensual and must be alive in that way. So we'll see some tensions there. And we'll probably see that in our inner world and in the outer world. And then full moon a week later brings us to the illumination and the light and the flowering. And this is Sagittarius, you know, and into the fire. And the intuition opens up and the vision and a kind of new way and a new direction. So Aries climbs that mountain to conquer it, but Sagittarius climbs to get a greater view of all that is. And in its right light, climbs slowly to take in everything along the path. And so we wouldn't usually see the Sagittarius and Taurus energy agreeing in this way, but when they come together, I think there is that beautiful exchange of Taurus saying, hey, Sagittarius, you're actually going to find your way to that quest more attentively if you do so slowly. Don't just like fire that arrow, right? Take your time to gracefully pull back the string and breathe before you release, you know. And so the illumination starts then. Sagittarius, also where Saturn is now, and I'll be talking about that in this longer version. But it's also saying, like, how can we find, like, new spiritual, I don't want to say beliefs, but, like, how can we find a quest that's based on beauty? And what does the earth, and just slowing down, teach us about spirituality? I mean, the scent of a rose might be a greater path to spirit than any other, as far as the Taurus archetype is concerned. And we get to the last quarter, and the fruiting and the wisdom comes in. And this is Pisces, and the water, and compassion, and the softness, and spirituality and transcendence, you know. And seeing that because the new moon is at the very late degrees of Taurus, then the three remaining principal phases of first quarter and full moon and last quarter are all on the mutable signs, the service to spirit signs. All right, well, let's look to the charts, the moon game. So here is right now. Here is the coming new moon in Taurus, 26 degrees, 56 minutes, Taurus. And you can see what else is going on in the chart, right? So where shall we begin? One beautiful thing about this chart that I really love is this conjunction that happened basically like the day of the Taurus new moon. This is Jupiter in Leo, where he's been for the last year, and this is Juno in Leo. Juno is an asteroid goddess, and they get together about every 4 years on average. Mythologically, Juno was the wife of Jupiter, or Hera and Zeus in the Greek, right? And they had a pretty tumultuous marriage. Zeus really pursuing intimacy in many other bedrooms outside of his marital chambers, and Hera being very angry about that and jealous. And instead of leaving, as a previous wife of his did, she just kind of tortured herself and tortured the many women outside of their marriage. And these, of course, are the stories that have survived and maybe probably definitely were not told by her. So feeling into that energy, Juno as an asteroid goddess is said to represent relationship. And so I love that they're coming together here in the sign of Leo. And they're very strongly trine to Uranus here in Aries. There's like this revolution of self and independence feeding into maybe this new look at the marriage between Juno and Jupiter. So when they get together, I think the question is, okay, is it going to be a fight? Or are they going to make love? And Taurus says, hey, make love, not war, right? And so we've got that going for us in this conjunction. Hopefully that's the time. I've spoken earlier about how this year, 2015, there are three exact conjunctions of Venus and Mars. The first, I think, was February 20th, right around the first degree of Aries, the vernal equinox point. The coming second conjunction will be August 31st. And that's at the Lammas point, which is right here, around 15 degrees Leo. So that's really interesting to me. It's almost like Juno and Jupiter are preparing this kind of matrimonial space for Venus and Mars to make their second conjunction, which will be in the morning sky on the very last day of August. So what do Venus and Mars, the feminine and masculine, have to say about this marriage? Well, here's Venus in Cancer. And traditionally, Venus is the ruler of Taurus. You know, our shamanic astrology likes to say that her energy is most tied to the Taurus mystery schools. It's actually not what shamanic astrology likes to say, but those are the words that came forth. But yeah, Venus energy is very much about Taurus energy, beauty, you know, grace, love, slowing down, being in the body. And so how is she participating at this time? Well, she's in the sign of Cancer, in a very important place of the sky. She's very strongly aligned to the beautiful star that is Sirius. She's square the north node you see in this chart, but what I'm mostly interested in, and this is like an aspect of tension, that square, but it's a third quarter square, which is an aspect of wisdom. And I think it's saying, as Venus explores this kind of Cancer energy of the nurturing mother and the waters of the heart, there's wisdom in that that helps us like see this long investigation. North Node and Libra, collective consciousness heading into the sign of relationship and harmony and balance and peace, which is so much of what I've been talking about, because the North Node's been there since February 2014 and will be there all the way until November of 2015, just after Venus and Mars make their last of these three 2015 embraces in the sign of Virgo. So this aspect is really interesting to me. And this is Venus trine Neptune. Neptune in Pisces, where it's been and will be for some time. And Venus in Cancer. So these waters, Cancer, the nurturing mother, the karuna, the unconditional love of mother for child, from which all other love springs. And then Pisces, more the merging heart, the, all the world's children are my children. And so I like that there's this kind of compassion, this karuna. And so from the Venus side, the yin side, feeding into this new marriage of Juno and Jupiter, maybe available in this conjunction, we have a lot of the hearts of compassion and motherly love and caring going into this. And so that's looking good from her side. From the Mars side, in Gemini. You know, kind of trickster and shapeshifter. And this is sometimes Jupiter's energy that got their relationship into some trouble. But Mars right now is in the underworld, so close to the sun that he's blinded by its glare. And in shamanic astrology, we consider that the initiation of the masculine. For reasons I won't describe now, we say that since April of 2014, Mars in the masculine energy has been pursuing the archetype of Libra and balanced relationship and this type of thing. Libra, the other sign traditionally associated with Venus. And that now is this time of Mars' long 26-month cycle where he's sun dancing. He's going through the initiations. And this happens when he gets so close to the sun that he can't be seen. He first entered there April 17th. Just around the time of the Aries new moon. And now he's pretty deep in there. And he won't come back until he's reborn in the morning sky. And this is August 5th. So there's something about the masculine energy in this initiation of relationship. You know, maybe, hey, Jupiter, have you stopped to think about how Juno felt, you know? And so she's kind of ready for this compassionate water, I think, to heal the relationship divide, to bring it to a place of Leo royalty leadership, where the king and the queen can sit on the throne side by side in equality. And the masculine energy is kind of going through the initiation to realize, as I've said before, that he has more ears than mouths, and to really learn how to honor that opinion of the feminine that's really coming online now. And the masculine then being this proponent for balanced and relationship. I mean, even marriage, however we want to look at that word, whether it's kind of a traditional aspect of, like, you know, monogamous relationship, that's not the only thing. What about the marriage to spirit and the inner marriage of ourselves and inner other? And a lot of that intention is coming in now. And so Mars in the underworld, and then also in opposition to Saturn, retrograde in Sag, who is a major player in this month again. And so that line, you know, it's like Saturn, you know, god of wisdom. And sometimes the old rules and authority figures that have to get reshaped, you know, I feel a lot of motherly energy in Saturn. Most astrologers laugh at me when I say that. And some say, yeah. Or some say, absolutely. And let me tell you more about that. But so I like this alignment here. It's like, hey, cool, Gemini, free living, eternal youth, trickster, shapeshifter, even the Don Juan energy, very cool. But let's make sure there's a spiritual purpose to that, a structure to that. So it's not just creating wounds that don't serve, you know? And so there's like a new life available, I think, in this relationship of husband and wife here with Jupiter and Juno. And Saturn's actually really helping Mars to say, yes, like, be young, have fun. Every kiss should be the first kiss, but do this in a structured, spiritual way that serves the fire, yeah, Sagittarius and Leo. And so Mercury also in Gemini, one of his signs, right, naturally. And Mercury, the day after this new moon, will go retrograde. And the planet police freak out. And look at that chart. So this is just the day after new moon. May 18th, 2015, 6:49 p.m. on the West Coast, Mercury goes retrograde, and look who's there. Mars, Moon, Mercury, all together. And so the Mercury retrograde cycle, you know, oh, don't sign contracts, don't travel, don't make important decisions, all these, like, fear-based things. I really would like for us to get out of that. You know, to me, the deal is that the planets, gods and goddesses, if you want to call them that, they haven't really been honored the way that we used to honor them, and they miss us, and they would love for us to speak with them. And so a few times a year, people start speaking to Mercury and speaking about Mercury, and, oh, he's going to come kill your computer, and everything's going to get ruined, and don't sign a contract, and don't travel, or certainly your plane will blow up, and, you know, all this fear. And he's like, oh, my God, they're talking about me. What do they want? They want me to blow up their computers? Okay. And then the question is, why does a computer blow up? But what if we start speaking to Mercury about different things? What if it's like, hey, man, like, I hear you're the god of the crossroads. I've got this important decision coming up. Can you help steer me in the way that's best for me, you know? I hear the god of travel. I would love to travel during your retrograde period. They said I shouldn't do that, but I'm going to. Will you be a watchful eye for me? Will you lead me into amazing new contemplations on my travel? And Mercury is mind. You know, when Mercury's retrograde, it's remember, reflect, respect. Caroline Casey, a wonderful astrologer who I just hung out with in D.C., she just told me this great thing about respect. It means to take a new look at something. And that's a really cool contemplation in that. So should we turn off all the computers because they're going to blow up? No. But can we relax that left brain and the computer mind and the worky-worky and all the language and stuff, where Mercury really excels, and honor the other side of self? And Taurus, new moon asks for that, right? Let's get into the body. What is the body mind? You know, if we want to communicate with a plant, are you going to try to talk English to it? Okay, but that's probably not what you're going to hear back. How can we get into the symbolic language? And you know, what does the Gemini glyph mean? And what does the Taurus glyph mean? And the Mercury retrograde periods have been some of the greatest astrological teachers to me, because I really get to relax this like super airy mind where astrology really exists and loves to live, but there's that whole other side of it that can't unfold until we relax a bit of that. So in the Mercury retrograde cycle, which is 3 weeks long, right, and will exist during the course of this Taurus new moon, Taurus wanting us to slow down, to be in the body, connect to the grace and the joy and the love. As I see a young lad walk down here carrying his father's huge shoe. Isn't that beautiful teaching? Yeah, you know, how can we just relax the brain, the to-do list, and all these things? And how can we listen when we're speaking so much, you know? And that whole idea of more ears than mouths, I really love. And so I think this retrograde Mercury cycle in the midst of the Taurus moon, and really cued to the beginning of the Taurus moon, day after Taurus new moon, and alive during the entirety of this moon, it's a really beautiful thing. Yeah, Taurus is about music and drumming and dancing, buddy. Let's hear it. And look at where that Mars, Moon, Mercury kind of triple conjunction are in this grand air trine. Okay, on one side, the North Node again, forward direction into relationship, into Libra. And then down here, Ceres, asteroid goddess of nurturing. I mean, she was the crops, right, Demeter, what feeds us, a very kind of agricultural and Taurusian type of thing that feeds into this dance, these three getting together here. And so Mars is in the underworld, the moon not quite visible yet the day after new moon, right, the darkness of the moon still, and Mercury now retrograding back into that place to join them, and maybe bringing our contemplation, Mercury, also into the heart, the moon, and then into Mars to say, right, like this kind of masculine wound, wah, 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 that's being addressed now, that we have this initiation for, to really heal. Let's bring our consciousness back. What in the past has wounded us? How have we betrayed others in our heart? How have we been betrayed? Actually, how is that not a betrayal at all? Because it's really served us to get to where we're going. And we see this sextile here, right, to the Juno-Jupiter thing. I really have a huge focus on the two of them getting together at this time, clearly. And then the square to Neptune. There's just like so much healing of the divide of the yin and the yang. And I kind of sound like a broken record on that one, but it's a record that wants to get fixed. This is alive at the new moon as well. Chiron conjunct Vesta in the sign of Pisces. Chiron, shaman healing, the sacred wound, Vesta, the spiritual flames, the sacred work, coming together to say, right, the work at this time is the healing of the merging, compassion, the one heart. You see what I'm saying? And so that's really contributing to this whole dance, and we'll see how they come alive in this moon game. So Mercury retrograde, we move into the first quarter moon. The sun will have moved into Gemini by then. We have these new moons in the very late degrees of the signs for most of this year. And that brings the moon game into these really fun territories where instead of the first quarter in full and last quarter all being in fixed signs like the Taurus new moon was, they're all in the mutable signs, like the first quarter moon is in the sign of Virgo. And not only squaring Sun, as first quarter implies, but also squaring this Mercury-Mars thing, which are really conjunct now and getting very close to the Sun. And this is what we call underworld. Mercury's retrograde, so he's between Earth and Sun, you can never get on the other side, but Mars is going behind the sun, like totally blinded in the fire, but also probably getting reinvigorated. And so I spoke earlier about kind of the virgin energy and the leaf of the tree challenging in ways the Taurus. So we see no planets in Taurus anymore, but in my moon game, in this moon game, it's about the intentions of Taurus, so those are still alive, even though the sun has shifted into Gemini. Venus and Uranus here in almost a perfect square. Actually, sorry, that is an absolutely perfect square, the first quarter square, okay? And that's an aspect of tension, right? So this is like the first quarter moon of when Venus was conjunct Uranus, when she was in the sign of Aries in February. This would have been in March. And she's come along now. Seeds that were planted of the goddess, like retrieving Aries, self, strength, you know, protection. But there's this mother bear energy, and now in Cancer, that's really alive, okay? And this is some energy, I think, that wants to get played with, danced with, even released for us to really connect to the beauty of Taurus. Sometimes that mother energy wants us to guard and protect to the point where we can't just chill out and be and feel. And the feelings that are so important are the feelings of the child or the feelings of the kin or the family, the tribe, this Cancer stuff, and forgetting about our own feelings, thinking that our heart finds happiness only when the other is happy, you know? And that's something that wants to be healed. And Aries helps with this, because Aries has that beautiful, independent aspect of self. And so I think that square is bringing that energy online. And Virgo, which is also so independent, you know, through her connection to the sacred work, the nature of the priestess, it's really alive there too. So that's fascinating to me, just looking at what's going on with like the yin energy of Venus and the yang energy of Mars during this course of the Taurus new moon, because Tantra and sensuality, and again also because of this Juno-Jupiter conjunction right at that time. And they, again, are trine to Uranus. So while there's this tension of like, hey, you know, Cancer, your duty is mother to the other, what about finding some of the fixed sign, fix yourself to fix the world, love yourself to bring more love to the world, know your beauty to bring more beauty to the world that's so alive now, and how is that contributing to and being energized by this revolution of self, reclaiming the spark of our fire so we can find our way to its roaring flames. And let's find our way back into relationship in that way, in a way of self-love. Now the sun in Gemini is in this opposition to Saturn. That's the midpoint of Saturn's retrograde period, which started on March 16th, when he gets in opposition to the sun. He's rising when the sun sets. And I think I'm going to leave that one there. Actually, I won't, because look at this really strong T-square, right? The first quarter moon, so moon square sun, and moon square Saturn. So the T-square between the three of them, all right? The fuel is now in Gemini, Mercury retrograde in Gemini, conjunct Mars in Gemini. There's this whole idea of what is eternal youth and the trickster and the magician and the shapeshifter and the Don Juan, and how does that find tension with the nature of the virgin, and how does this all seed into this dance with like the structure of the spiritual quest? And we can see, and it wants Pisces, and here's Neptune close enough, saying, right, healing and higher vision and compassion and merging, that's all alive in this thing. So let's enjoy this tension of trickster to sacred work, and to understand how they can be the one and the same. And since this is all happening during the Taurus moon, that this is one of the ways that we can really tend to purge Taurus shadows, bring in its beauty, and again, like, beauty as a spiritual path seems to be really alive here. So we'll look to the week of flowering, the full moon week, and here is moon in Sagittarius, opposite that Gemini moon, and now Mars 4 degrees to one side of the sun, and Mercury 4 degrees to the other. Mars behind the sun, Mercury in front of the sun. Neither of them can be seen because they're so close to the sun. But what can be seen is the moon in its full illumination, the full moon in Sagittarius. And again, as I said earlier, I feel that this is like the spiritual flowering of a practice of beauty and embodiment. You know, there's that yoga thing of the tree will not grow to the heavens until its roots are planted in the soil and really know the body. Like, we came here to embody and to be in the monkey suit, and it's meant to be part of our evolution and our transcendence. So let's not try to attain heaven by just escaping the body, but by loving the body that we've chosen to come explore the beauty of this earth as our spiritual practice. That seems to be really alive in this month, and that's maybe where these fires and this new marriage of Leo honor comes from. This whole scene has now reached sextile to the Juno-Leo conjunction. They're still trine to Uranus, and the moon is like kind of creeping into where it's going to make the grand fire trine. In fact, a couple days, actually the next day, right, we'll get that grand fire trine. So still a very full moon, conjunct Pallas Athena, the wisdom, right? And very close to galactic center, Hunabku, grandmother. I don't want to get lost going into all of this stuff, but there's a lot of the energy of the fire coming online. So Uranus and Aries, the new spark, the revolution of self that gives us the pioneering spirit to do something new, the roaring flames of the fire in Leo of self-love and confidence, allowing for us to have this new type of relationship without jealousy, where the king and the queen can sit on the throne side by side in honor. And that feeds us to the smoke of wisdom that travels far and wide and rises to the heavens. And I love that this bright full moon gets in on that action, right? And that makes what is called kite to this Gemini dance a little bit. It's not really in very strong orb, we would say, because the stuff's in the 20s and the stuff's down in the teens. But this Gemini action, especially Mercury retrograde at this point, look, now he's the main contributor to the grand air trine with North Node and Libra in Ceres and Aquarius. See, there's Ceres and Aquarius, there's the freedom of the mothering principle. And we saw that in that first quarter moon with Venus square Uranus. How can we find a new freedom to free, like, the mother from being so attached to protecting the child that it turns into a need and she loses herself to it? This is part of how Taurus is teaching us to slow down and just to be. A friend this morning said, you know, he's fathering in the city, and it's, oh, I have to get her ready for school and then ready for bed and everything. And it's like, I'm this commander, and I don't want to be that. And then, but when we go out to our cabin in nature, she gets to be the leader, you know, and do whatever she wants, and I can follow her around. And Taurus says, remember that? Remember the simple life? When there wasn't this whole agenda, and we didn't have to, like, pay bills, we just had to, like, get our hands in the soil and grow our food. And was that some toil like we were told it was without the convenience of modern machines and all this stuff? Or was there actually a beauty and a simplicity to it? And while we do live these city lives and we're all decreasing the size of our footprint or whatnot, there's also this energy about how can we find simplicity within the busyness. Yeah, and I think Taurus is teaching us this. And again, this moon seems to be like, what is the spiritual practice of that? And sometimes the serious concern for others, you know, has us so busy in our energy that we can't chill out. And Taurus wants that from us more than anything else, perhaps. All right, so we move to the last quarter. And look at Saturn, it's retrograde now. The very lowest minutes of the Sagittarius sign heading back into Scorpio, where he will go during the course of the Gemini move. Mercury still retrograde, okay? Opposition to Saturn. Mars started in opposition to Saturn, and now Mercury's back there. So I said that thing about, like, bringing that eternal youth Gemini energy into form of spiritual practice, I think, and the true quest of using Gemini as a service to spirit, which it truly is. But it can be confusing to find our way to that. Mercury's done this whole thing of, like, let's bring our consciousness back and reflect and have retrospection in this, and moving through the kind of masculine energy in Gemini and in the sun, and getting a new mission, you know, Kazemi, that's called in some of the traditional systems, when Mercury is in directly between Earth and Sun. That's May 30th, this month, the interior conjunction. And this is Mercury in the throne room of the sun, kind of getting the new message to bring forth as he's reborn in the morning sky soon after, later in this month. This is June 9th, the last quarter moon this time. We see the moon in Pisces conjunct Chiron. I'll get right back to that. But one thing I want to say is that Venus on June 6th, and I actually want to see this date, reaches what's called maximum elongation. You've seen her in the western sky after sunset, so bright, and she's getting higher and higher and higher. This is the ascent of the goddess. And on June 6th, though she's still ascending, she reaches her the highest place she can get in the sky, the furthest distance she can be from the sun, which is about 47 degrees on average, her furthest distance from the sun. This is a very bright evening Venus, and it happens just as she's crossed into Leo. And she's about to have a whole 19-month investigation of Leo that starts late August, and we'll be talking a lot about that moving forward. But it's like, hey, all right, like, I did some of these initiations around Cancer. I brought this loving heart, and, like, now I'm ready to jump into this Leo. I'm ready to find, like, self-love, and this is the height of my path. And so I really love that energy. And the moon joining Ceres, you know, there's, like, that, again, that kind of freedom of, like, the mothering, caring energy, and doing that in a free way that really helps seed us with this courageous power of self-love that is the magic of our manifestation. And so the goddess is moving through into that energy, and all this again in this moon game, participating with the Taurus intentions. And so the last quarter moon, we find this very strong T-square. Moon conjunct Chiron in Pisces. Sun conjunct Mars in Gemini, Pallas Athena in Sagittarius. And I feel like getting all mythological. And I don't think I will so much. What I will say is, like, the wisdom of this moon cycle of Taurus brings us to this place of deep healing of the sacred womb of merging and the one heart, you know. There's been a lot of that attention in the last couple of years of really having this North Node in Libra focus of moving into relationship, rewriting relationship, the three Venus-Mars conjunctions of 2015, rewriting our relationship to relationship, this Juno-Jupiter conjunction that this whole month enjoys, and now, you know, this wound around merging and the opening of the heart and the opening to the softness and the flow of the water. And I love the Pisces symbol because we see these two fish, you know, but they're kind of bending away from each other, but they're tied together. They're holding hands in a sense. And the moon just bringing, like, love and compassion to that. And what is the beauty of that? And if there is, like, a tantric practice this moon, if that's part of your Taurus intentions, this really seems to be the spiritual wisdom that's beginning to unfold through that practice. And you know how these things are. We could go on and on and on. But maybe that's the right place to leave this one. No. The other thing is, Pallas Athena, who is the wisdom in Sag, is now in this very strong grand fire trine to Uranus in Aries and Jupiter Juno in Leo. We saw that a little bit in the third quarter of month, but it's really strong here. And there's, like, this wisdom again of the revolution of self that helps us find self-love so we can really connect to others in such a way that is a spiritual path. And Pallas Athena becomes this very key player in this chart. In that T-square with Moon Chiron and Sun Mars, and in the Grand Fire Trine with Uranus. And so I just kind of want to speak about Pallas Athena really quickly. She was born from the head of Zeus. She was the daughter of Metis, who was his first wife, and he ate, it said, that first wife because there was this rumor that their child would take his kingdom. But Pallas Athena refused to die, and she was born out of his head. Midwifed by Prometheus, who's very much the Uranus energy. And she was fully clad in armor and went straight to kicking butt. She was the goddess of war, but the wisdom of war. And she had this dance with Mars for a time. I don't want to get this too deep into the stories because I feel like we're reaching our end. But there's this whole statement, I think, about spiritual wisdom and like the wisdom of like the goddess energy, the Athena energy, and that kind of release from mind to find like some of the spiritual energy. And is there English for that? Yeah, I think actually getting out of all these words and honoring the Mercury retrograde and honoring the Taurus archetype and kind of more feeling this in the body is what's more important. And so I think there's just this one sentence that I've said a couple times, and it's, beauty is a spiritual practice. And so with that, your cup of roses, thank you for playing the Taurus moon game. This is your friendly astrolonaut, Gemini Brett, signing off. I will see you in space.